Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I am Representative Steve Malagari, and it is a pleasure to be here this evening, and I want to thank everybody for tuning in. We have round two of a Spotted Lanternfly forum and discussion and a learning exercise that we are going to be learning from Penn State Extension. We are so happy to have Emily Swackhammer back with us again to tell us about the Spotted Lanternfly. Why is it important? Why is it important to our economy? What are the effects? What could be? We are still in a quarantine zone, as they call it, for the Spotted Lanternfly. What does that look like? What do we need to do to really mitigate against this invasive insect species? And I'm sure many of you have been out there stomping, swatting, and trying to remove and potentially destroy as many of these as possible that you might see in your yards. I know that we are in the middle of a global pandemic as well, and the last thing you probably are thinking about is the spotted lanternfly, but from my own staff experience and from many of the constituents that are on this call, you've started seeing them crawl up your trees and jump onto your car. Some of them hopped onto me, actually, personally. And you're starting to see these actual insects fly around and hop from tree to tree and car to car and person to person. And now is the time that we need to be very vigilant about trying to get rid of as many as possible. But then also, once we go into the winter and then into the spring again, we got to start searching for those egg casings so we can scrape them, remove them, get rid of them, destroy them, and then we start all over again with the life cycle of the spotted lanternfly. So, Emily, I'm gonna put this over to you. First off, before we start, I wanted to say thank you to my staff and my team for putting this together again and all the coordination to bring this to you on the pahouse.com/Malagari. If you go to repmalagari.com, there's a link there. You can watch this as well and watch it live. So I'm looking forward to a lot of the questions that are coming through, and I look forward to another great presentation. Thank you, Emily. This is over to you now.
Okay, well, thank you for hosting me tonight. I know we're going to be talking to people that probably have a lot of spotted lanternfly in their neighborhood, and a lot of people are dealing with it. Okay, let me find my presentation. Here we go. All right, how does that look? Can you see it?
Yep, we can, Emily.
Thank you. Okay, so my task tonight is to do an update for you. And I've been working with the spotted lanternfly since its first discovery in 2014. I live very close to the area where it was first discovered, so it immediately impacted my community, but also my work. I work for Penn State Extension, and I am an extension educator. My assignment is horticulture. We are the outreach arm of the College of Ag Sciences into the community. Our office in Montgomery County is in Creamery, which is just outside of Skipack. But I really cover the whole state for a lot of different issues, and spotted lanternfly has been a big issue for me recently. Some of you might be familiar with Penn State Extension. If you've ever heard of 4-H, that's our youth program. But we also offer many programs for the community on family and consumer sciences, agronomy. We have an equine program, and the list goes on and on. So check out Penn State Extension for all sorts of other offerings. But really, we do have the longest track record with spotted lanternfly, and we are delivering research-based information. So I just want to point out that everything that I'm going to say tonight is can be found on our spotted lanternfly website. So if you just go to Google and search Penn State spotted lanternfly, you'll find this page. And this is just part of it, but you see there's some important features here. You can report it if you find it. You can see pictures so you can identify it in all of its life stages. And then there's a whole lot of information behind that manage button. So everything that I'm going to say tonight exists on our Penn State website. So the spotted lanternfly, here's a great picture that one of our ag sciences photographer took with, good lighting. It's a plant hopper. It's native to Asia. It was first found in southeastern Pennsylvania in 2014. And now it has spread to 6 states and detected in 4 additional states. And you know what? This week it was announced that they know it is on Staten Island. So it's really now spread to 7 states. I wanted to just take a minute to talk briefly about invasive species in general. So there are invasive species in every part of the world from places where they should, where they came from. And there are invasive species here that a lot of things that are here came from Asia, but there are invasive species in Asia that came from North America. So I looked into it and, you know, things that are very familiar with us are invasive in Asia and causing some problems. Bullfrogs, rainbow trout, raccoons. Can you imagine having invasive raccoons come to your community? Snapping turtles, fall webworms. And this is a really long list. I've just picked some out that you might be familiar with. It's just really a fact of our global society that we're going to have invasive problems. And what we need to do is figure out how we're going to react to invasives and, you know, where we go from here. So here is the spotted lanternfly map. This is done by the New York State IPM program, Integrated Pest Management. We're going to talk about IPM here in a little bit when we get into our management section. But this map was just updated on August 14th, and it shows a lot of good stuff. So here's Pennsylvania, and you can see we have 26 counties that are marked in blue that are under quarantine because we know there are established populations of spotted lanternfly in these counties. Then in western New Jersey, northern Delaware, northern Maryland, northern Virginia, West Virginia, and for the first time in New York State on Staten Island. So these blue areas are where we know the spotted lanternfly is established. And the U.S. Department of Agriculture is in, especially the periphery of these areas, doing all they can to contain and control it and prevent it from spreading any further. So we have a quarantine in Pennsylvania, but the other states also have their infested counties under quarantine. And I'm going to talk about what that means for us here in a few minutes. On this map, you'll see there are also some like purple dots. And that shows where individual finds of spotted lanternfly have been made, but the authorities who went and scouted those areas have not been able to determine that there's a population established. So you can see, though, that this spotted lanternfly has the ability to move around pretty far. And really, the way it gets, you know, long distances is through human intervention. And we're trying to prevent people from moving it around through education and, you know, being careful about cleaning things before they take them somewhere else. This is from a paper that was published last year where the authors took all kinds of information about the length of the growing season, the coldness of the winter temperatures, the plants that are available, and that they did mathematical modeling to produce this map, which shows the potential distribution of spotted lanternfly in the U.S. So if you look here in the East Coast, you know, these orange areas are starting to look kind of familiar, where we believe there's the highest probability, that's the orange color, that spotted lanternfly can survive, is pretty much where we're finding it in Pennsylvania. The green areas, the yellow to green areas go from medium to low, and then we know it will have a northern range at some point. The problem with this map, and this clearly shows, that the spotted lanternfly could live throughout the Midwest. It could live in the grape-growing regions of New York State, up into New England, you know, down into parts of the South, the Mid-Atlantic South, and the Central Valley of California, the fruit-growing regions of the Pacific Northwest. We are really trying to stop spotted lanternfly from getting into those areas. So I'm going to spend some time on the biology of the lanternfly. I think it really helps people understand more of its behavior, and part of it is how it feeds. So the spotted lanternfly feeds on the plant, and they feed on the sap. They use a piercing, sucking mouth part. So you can see it on this picture. I'm going to draw a white box around it. So there it is. That's a piercing, sucking mouth part. And it's like a big straw that they insert into the vascular system of the plant, and they start to withdraw the sap. As they're withdrawing the sap, they pull more into their bodies than they really need, and they excrete the waste of that out the other end in the form of something that we affectionately call honeydew, which is really the sugary water left over from the sap. And that honeydew will fall down onto any surface below. So they are doing this from the time they hatch out from the eggs. When they first hatch out, they're in the nymph stage, and that mouth part is very young and tender. And they feed on the succulent parts of the plant, the leaves, the petioles of the leaves. As they get bigger and bigger, that mouth part gets stronger and stronger. And by the time they're adults, they can drill that mouth part right through the bark of trees. So they'll be feeding often down lower on the tree trunks. We believe that their feeding behavior is likely reliant on the turgor pressure of the plant. So we think that the plant has to have enough pressure in its vascular system to push the sap into that mouth part. We haven't found any musculature around their mouth part where they can actually pull the sap into their bodies. So we think that they really seek out plants that have a lot of sap pressure or turgor pressure, and they really like those plants. And that might explain some of the behavior where you see them congregating on one particular tree in very high numbers. We believe that plant has a lot of sap that can push its way into their mouth parts. So here's a picture that I took just today. I went out to get my mail, and I found a lanternfly feeding on a tree, and I was able to take this picture where its mouth part is going right into sort of a fissure in mature bark, and this lanternfly was just happily feeding. So it was quite happy until I took its picture, and then I smashed it, and then it wasn't happy. So spotted lanternfly does a lot of damage to grapes, and you probably have heard something about this. This is a picture that really illustrates the problem, and this is a large area of grapevines that were killed by the feeding pressure of spotted lanternflies. So the block of grapes in the front here, you see the dead vines, or it's kind of like the stumps of the grapevines. This block was one particular cultivar of grapes called Gewürztraminer. In the background here on the other hillside, there are other cultivars of grapes that are affected by lanternfly. You can see they're showing kind of a red coloration, which is a stress symptom, but they're not as heavily affected. So we believe that some grapes are more susceptible to the lanternfly feeding damage than others, but we're really just learning a lot about that. We also know that it has a lot to do with where the grapevines or the plants are situated. So if there's a lot of trees that the lanternflies love in a wood line, and the lanternflies live in that wood line all summer, then in the fall, they have this behavior where they really like to fly into the vineyards. And so if it's a block of grapes that are nearby to a woodlot, there's more likelihood that lanternflies will move in from those areas. We know that spotted lanternfly has killed a lot of acreage of grapes in southeastern Pennsylvania, and we're very worried about it getting into the Erie, Pennsylvania area where they grow a lot of grapes for juice and to other grape-growing regions of the country. So spotted lanternfly has this piercing, sucking mouth part. Here's a picture of adults where they're piercing through the bark, the mature bark of a tree. And this is a tree of heaven, which is one of their favorite trees. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. But on this particular tree, they're piercing through the bark, and then the tree is weeping out sap. So you see these dark areas of sap flowing down the trunk. The lanternflies are pulling in lots of sap into their body and is excreting the honeydew, which is falling on everything below. And then there are fungi that grow on that honeydew because there's a lot of sugar there. Collectively, we call those fungi sooty mold, and it makes the areas under the lanternflies this blackish kind of color, and everything's kind of sticky. So on Tree of Heaven, we also sometimes see this white accumulation, and that is also microbes. It's yeasts and possibly bacteria, and they're also growing on all of this honeydew. So a very strange and not pleasant odor develops, and sometimes you can smell trees that have this level of infestation of spotted lanternfly before you come to them. So it has a very distinctive smell. So this is a very unpleasant thing to have in your landscape, and this is part of why it is such a nuisance to have. So I have a video. See if this will run. It ran earlier. No. Try one more time. That's not going to run. Okay. Well, this video shows stinging insects coming in and out of the field of view. And so things like yellow jackets will come to these groups of spotted lanternfly. They like to collect the honeydew, which is a sweet, sticky substance, sort of like yellow jackets will come to an open can of soda in the summer. They like to collect that sweetness. So this is another problem for residential landscapes because some people are allergic to stinging insects, so it's just not good. Well, how is this affecting the health of the tree? We have only seen spotted lanternfly kill tree of heaven, one of its favorite hosts, the tree I'm going to talk about in a few minutes, and grapes. We have seen it kill seedlings of walnuts as well. But really, it's not an insect that we that's been killing, you know, we haven't seen it kill a lot of landscape trees. And I think that's a really important message for people because, you know, if you have spotted lanternfly, there's a lot of management options, and we don't want people to panic because they're fearful of the damage the lanternfly will cause to their trees. If your trees are otherwise healthy, you know, we have a lot of options, and don't go, you know, too off the deep end with what you do or how much you spend on the trees. So spotted lanternfly definitely hurts plants, but to date, it has only killed tree of heaven. It's one of its favorite hosts, small tree saplings, and that would be walnut and grapevines, but not other plants. Really important point to get out there. Spotted lanternfly does definitely stress trees, though. So we have scientific evidence where we've measured the photosynthetic rate of trees and then subjected them to varying levels of spotted lanternfly pressure. And we've documented that it does reduce the plant's ability to photosynthesize. So, you know, we really don't know what's going to happen yet after several years of heavy feeding pressure. And we're also wondering if we would get a severe drought year, you know, what would happen then? We have had decent rainfall since spotted lanternfly has been here, but we live in an area where we do sometimes get summer droughts. And will the trees be more stressed in a drought year? We don't know. Well, there was a group of researchers that did an economic impact study, and they worked, it was a grant funded by the Center for Rural Pennsylvania. And you can find the whole report. I've listed the link here, but you can Google your way to finding it. They used data from the 2017 Census of Agriculture, and they surveyed crop production experts, and they used that information to estimate the annual direct economic impact of spotted lanternfly damage on Pennsylvania agriculture. And it is a long report, but there's like a two-page executive summary that boils it all down. They did this study when only 14 counties were known to be infested, and they were in the quarantine zone, QZ. And they calculated that the 14-county zone had sustained a $13.1 million of economic damage from spotted lanternfly that year. Adjacent counties, they calculated, had sustained $7.7 million, and statewide $42.6 million. So the losses, of course, are projected to fall especially on nursery operators, grape growers, Christmas tree growers, producers. But they also had a section in the report where they did calculations based on suppliers to these agricultural operations, and then the induced effects, which translates into the workers that work for all of these companies and how it affected their finances. And they figured that we're sustaining about a $324.9 million economic loss for spotted lanternfly, and that was based on the data they had from 2019 when they really did this study. So as spotted lanternfly builds more and more of its population, expands into new areas, this number is only going to go up. So we have a quarantine in Pennsylvania, and it affects every resident. And it doesn't matter if you don't live in the quarantine area, it still affects you. So for residents, if you need to move an object, you can get this checklist for residents. This is a legal document. And what you do is you print it out and you fill out the second side of it is a checklist of what you're going to move. And, you know, there's places where you can write in, you know, other objects that are not on the list. You sign it, you date it, you take it with you when you move that object. So that object needs to be inspected and cleaned of any living life stage of spotted lanternfly. This will put you into compliance with the quarantine. If you were stopped and somebody said, hey, you're moving an item, you know, do you have you inspected it? Are you in compliance with quarantine? If you have this document, you are. Some campgrounds are starting to ask for this when people are bringing their RVs to their areas. But really, it applies to virtually any solid object, vehicles or any object. Businesses need to go a step further. They need a spotted lanternfly permit, and this is all enacted by the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture, and it's their job to protect agriculture in the state. So here's one of their Facebook pieces, keep your business moving, get a spotted lanternfly permit. This is our director of our local PDA office, Howard Walker, and he's showing his permit for his state car. So all agencies, Penn State requires that I have a permit. All agencies shall have this permit. If you know anybody that has a business or you need one for your own business, go to the Penn State Spotted Lanternfly webpage and you'll easily find your way through to a recorded class that you can take, and then you take the quiz at the end. You need to pass it with a certain percentage, and when you do that, you'll be issued your permit. The permit used to be these orange hang tags, but now they've started sending like a paper permit that that you can keep in your vehicle. And getting the permit is really only the first part of the step. The second and probably most important thing is that you're doing due diligence to not move spotted lanternfly around. You're inspecting every item that you're moving and you're keeping records of those inspections. So that's, you know, very briefly what the permitting process involves. So why are we fighting the spotted lanternfly? Well, I think I've already given you a lot of reasons, and I have this great picture of lots of dead spotted lanternfly. We're, of course, concerned about the health of plants. It's a nuisance in landscapes. We want to protect our businesses. And just as kind of more food for thought, Pennsylvania is the number one producer of hardwoods in the United States. Our hardwood industry figures into the billions of dollars per year. We don't want any of our trade partners to be at all concerned about bringing Pennsylvania hardwood products into their area. So we trade with everybody in the country, but also many international people. And it's not just hardwoods. It's every business that's moving anything. All businesses that ship anything are at risk. So let's get back to biology a little bit. The spotted lanternfly has a very broad host range. And we know that it has some preferred plants. So we know it really likes the tree of heaven or Ailanthus altissima. So I have two pictures here of tree of heaven. And the tree of heaven has this big compound leaf. These leaves can get up to 3 feet long or longer. And it has many leaflets off the central stem. And it's a good thing if you can identify the tree of heaven so you're watching that tree. Because if you have a lot of tree of heaven around, it allows the spotted lanternfly populations to really build. Here are some of the nymphs feeding on Tree of Heaven, and we have seen them in very, very high numbers. So we know Tree of Heaven is very attractive to them. They really like it, and I'll talk later about how we actually use this attraction as a management tool. But we know spotted lanternfly likes a lot of other plants, and I have a very condensed list here. Grape, of course, black walnut, they love black walnut, silver and red maple, birch, willow, staghorn sumac, so some of our really important native plants, rose. Early in the season, we often see them on rose first in their nymph stage, and then just others. There was just a paper that just got published today by one of our Pennsylvania Department of Ag people that lists many, many plants that we have documented spotted lanternfly feeding on. This makes them very unusual. Most pests that affect landscape plants or crops attack one plant, one type of plant, or a family of plants. This insect is just completely different, and it makes it very hard to manage. One kind of good note is that we have not recorded substantial feeding on conifers. So if you have pines or spruce, arborvitae, evergreen trees, we know they can take a taste of them, but they don't really seem to like them very much. So spotted lanternfly also has this unusual behavior that they move around a lot. So this is out of one of our fact sheets that's on our website. But we know that there are plants that spotted lanternfly can be predictably found on at different times of the year. So I mentioned rose. You would look for spotted lanternfly mostly on rose in their early nymph stages in May and June. Grape and tree of heaven, we know spotted lanternfly can be found on those plants throughout the growing season. Black walnut and butternut, they seem to like them in their nymph stage and then going in up until the adult stage, but then they tend to leave those plants and they go to other plants like river birch, willow, sumac, silver and red maple. So you'll often find the adults feeding on those plants later in the year. Again, this makes them really hard to manage because you have to kind of be one step ahead of the lanternfly to predict where they're going to go next. So let's quickly go over the life cycle. I assume everybody has seen spotted lanternfly, but I want to make sure you can recognize it in all of its life stages. So we'll start here in the beginning of the season. They hatch out from the eggs. That usually happens mostly in May, but that some early ones can hatch out in April and they can hatch all the way up until June. So they don't hatch all out at once. They kind of keep coming. When they first hatch out, they're black with white spots and they're tiny. I'll show you a real picture, not just a drawing here in a minute. They shed their skins between the nymphal stages and every time, you know, every stage we call an instar. So the first instar is really tiny, the second instar is a little bigger, third instar, a little bigger, but still black with white spots. The fourth instar has this beautiful red coloration. They really are quite pretty. And at this point, they're maybe a quarter of an inch long. So the fourth instar will shed its skin, and then there's no cocoon or pupal stage. And I have a picture showing the adult crawling right out of this fourth instar. And then the adults will start to feed. They start to emerge in July, and they will feed for a long time, weeks, until they mate and start to lay their eggs. So the egg laying starts to happen usually in late September. We're a little earlier this year, so be watching for it a little earlier. And during this time, they're taking in a tremendous amount of sap to get enough energy to grow the eggs that they need to lay. When they lay their eggs, they lay their eggs and then cover them with this substance, a secretion from the female's body that dries down to almost look like a splooch of mud on the tree and or on the object that she has laid her eggs on. So it's important to know how to identify the eggs as well. The adults will die with the first killing frost. They're not going to get through the cold winters, and the eggs are the only life stage that will overwinter. So that's why we go out in the spring, in the late winter, early spring, trying to destroy the eggs. So some real pictures of the life stages. This is a picture of a first instar nymph. That's how big they are. They're really small. And they're feeding on the tender parts of the plant, so usually the leaves. They jump in all of their mobile life stages. So this little nymph can jump a long distance. This is a great picture of three instars, the first, second, and third instar, all lined up here on an Asiatic bittersweet stem, which is one of the plants they do also like. So I thought this was a really great photograph that one of my friends took, and I love to show people what the three instars look like in size-wise in relation to each other. And then this is a picture showing that fourth instar stage with the red coloration. This is on a walnut, and they're often found on the outer twigs of walnut in this stage. This is a picture showing that fourth instar, and the adult is crawling out. So when they first crawl out, they're very light in color, and it takes a little while for them to oxidize and turn their darker color. But this is just wild to see this happen. You can't imagine how such a big-looking adult fit into that fourth instar. So then we have the adult stage, and this is just a very typical picture of them feeding on a tree of heaven. So here's a picture showing a tree of heaven, which they do like to lay their eggs on. And this was taken in the Norristown Farm Park. So there are quite a few tree of heaven in the park there, and these are the egg masses on the trunk of the tree. So the females will often seek out protected areas to lay their eggs, and this was kind of where the trunk was had a curvature where it's going into the ground, and there was a protected area there. So a lot of females laid eggs there. Those are a lot of egg masses. There's so many, they're almost coalesced together. In the upper right, I've put a picture of an egg mass to show you some more detail of what they look like. The female lays her eggs in rows, and there will be between about 30 to 50 eggs per egg mass. She covers them with a secretion from her body, which dries down. And through the year, it gets kind of more and more dry looking. But in some cases, the female misses some of the eggs. We don't know why this happens, but this is a characteristic that you can look for. It's not unusual. And in this picture, it gives you a chance to see what the eggs themselves really look like. So here is a compilation of pictures that really illustrates the problem and how easy it would be to move viable egg masses. So this is from my colleague, Heather Leach, and she writes, they laid eggs on what? Love it. Yeah, I can't believe it. A light bulb on the fabric of lawn furniture, the rubber of tires, but also they will lay on rusty metal. So if you had a vehicle and they laid eggs on that vehicle and you didn't clean it and you took it somewhere else, you know, you took it on a road trip, you could very easily spread spotted lanternfly. This is the underside of a planter from a deck. So look on the undersides of things. And this is a piece of firewood. Don't move firewood around. There are other insects that have been moved around in firewood. Always buy firewood locally and burn it locally. So what is the risk from spotted lanternfly? I have this kind of bubble diagram. This is how Heather likes to talk about it. So everybody has sort of a different situation. So maybe you're most concerned about the feeding damage from spotted lanternfly. Maybe you're a grape grower. Maybe you just have them really heavily in your landscape and you're concerned about the health of your plants. Of course, there's a lot of people concerned about the nuisance issues. The honeydew is annoying. It rains down out of the trees. It gets on your hair. It's on my glasses. It's everything sticky. The sooty mold forms. The bugs or stinging insects swarm around. It's definitely a nuisance. And then there's this compliance with the quarantine issue. So if you have a business and you have to spend extra time or hire additional people to inspect your items and, you know, keep those records, maybe that's more where your concern is. Most people are somewhere in the middle here. And really, we all have these concerns. Everybody's affected by the quarantine. So that's one way of looking at it. I wanted to remember to talk about the fact that we know there are other creatures and things out in nature that will kill spotted lanternfly. So that's what we call biological control. So we know spiders will catch them and eat them. We know praying mantids will eat them, and it's kind of fun to watch. We know that the wheel bug or some of the assassin bugs will eat them. These are all very general predators, and they will catch and eat almost any insect that they can grab. So we don't think these are really doing a lot to control the numbers of spotted lanternfly, but it's good to know that, you know, that at least they're helping in a small way. And then there are tiny parasitic wasps. So this is one of them. This shows the size bar. It's a half a millimeter. So the whole tiny little wasp is maybe a millimeter and a half long. It's so small, you would hardly even know it was there. But these tiny wasps are very specific for usually the eggs of other insects. And the one I'm showing, one of our Department of Conservation and Natural Resources researchers has found this one crawling out of killed eggs of spotted lanternfly. This is a tiny wasp that was brought here years ago to control the gypsy moth. And it's naturalized now here in Pennsylvania. There are other tiny parasitic wasps in Asia that in the spotted lanternfly's natural range keep them in check, in balance. So the U.S. Department of Agriculture has brought some of those tiny parasitic wasps to a quarantine facility in Massachusetts. And they're under lock and key, but they're doing all kinds of very interesting experiments to try to figure out if they would ever release those insects, would they have negative impacts on any of our native insects? And could we use it? Could we release it and use it? It takes a very long time for that kind of research to happen. So, you know, we're hopeful, but it's not going to be any kind of an immediate answer. But one thing that came up that might provide more control more immediately are the fungal pathogens. So we've discovered actually several different fungi that kill spotted lanternfly. And this one, Bavaria bassiana, you can see the fungal tissue growing out of the dead corpse of the insect. And it's kind of growing out of the joints of the legs and, you know, the eyes. And it's really kind of, you know, great for Halloween. But this is a naturally occurring fungus in Pennsylvania. And in especially wet falls, we have seen that it knocked back a lot of adults. So that happened in 2018. And this naturally occurring fungus, Bavaria bassiana, is available as a formulated insecticide product. We've had it on the market for a long time for other uses. And now the researchers are trying to figure out if we could use it on a broader scale to, you know, protect woodland areas around vineyards, transportation corridors, things like that. So there's work going on. At the moment, the results are kind of mixed and not super encouraging, but we're going to keep trying to find these natural solutions. So what can people do, you know, homeowners and residents? Well, I'm going to take you through some of the different options. You can scrape eggs into a container and put some alcohol in that container, and that will kill the eggs. So you can scrape them, or you can just smash them. So this is something that a lot of people are doing on their own properties. Don't get up on ladders, but if you can destroy it, one egg mass, you're destroying between 30 and 50 eggs that would turn into lanternflies to annoy you the following year. Another thing that people have done, and we're learning with this, early on, a lot of people were using sticky tree bands. And in early years, the tree bands were brown. So the nymphs have this behavior where they're up feeding in the tender parts of the tree, up on the leaves, and then they'll blow out of the trees and fall down to the ground. And the they walk along the ground and they'll go back to a trunk or a stem of a plant because they need to constantly feed, and they'll go back up. So as they're going up, if you have a barrier of sticky material, you can see the sticky band is filling up with the dead bodies of nymphs, and they fill from the bottom up. So this is a good way to catch thousands of lanternflies, but this has one major drawback, and that is that other creatures have gotten tangled up on these sticky bands. So you don't want that to happen. We're telling everybody, if you're going to use sticky bands, you have to put some sort of protection around it to keep birds and other creatures off. Wire is one option. These are some different designs that the master gardeners that volunteer with our office were trying. But really, we've decided now that netting is best because then you can keep spiders and small creatures off of the sticky bands as well. You just need to have whatever you're using open at the bottom so the lanternflies can climb up the trunk and get to that sticky paper. But you want to have sort of a, you know, a protection of a netting down over it. So if you know anybody that's using sticky bands for lanternflies and they don't have some sort of protection around it, you know, please spread the word about this. This is something that, you know, early on a lot of people were doing this, but I see more and more sticky bands with that protection now, and that's good. So recently, in the last year or so, we've done work, research, figuring out, you know, if there's other ways to trap lanternflies. This is called a circle trap, and you can buy this commercially from one company, or you can make them. And I have a fact sheet up on our Penn State website that takes you through the steps of how you can make traps using wire netting and things that you have around the house, maybe. And they're not really hard to build. You do need to kind of engineer it a little to fit the diameter of the tree you're working with and so on. But this is a trap that I built, and you can see I was catching the early instar nymphs, and there were hundreds and hundreds of them. They climb up into the bag and die within a day. And you don't have to change the bag very often, or, you know, don't have to do anything to kill them in there. They really don't find their way back out again. So hopefully people are going to start using circle traps. If you build one or more for your landscape, you can take them down in the fall, store them, and use them the next year. So another thing that I see people doing is trying to spray the lanternflies. So, you know, people will look under their sink and in their medicine cabinet in the garage, and you see a lot of this on social media about using home remedies. And Penn State is saying, no, don't do this. A lot of these products are really toxic. I've had people tell me they're spraying their trees with bleach. You know, bleach is really toxic, and it's not labeled for use that way. It's not safe for humans or pets. It's toxic to beneficial insects. These products may harm your plants. So you don't want to burn every leaf on your plant in your attempt to try to protect it from lanternfly. Some of them are flammable. It's technically illegal to do this. You really should only use something that is labeled by the Environmental Protection Agency and has instructions for how to use it safely. And these are all things, you know, the things that you want to use, you can find at garden centers. So what kinds of pesticides can you use? Well, read the label of the products first. And now with, you know, access on the internet, you can read a label of any product before you ever buy it. And that is so helpful because you can do the calculations of how much you need to buy, and you wind up not buying too little or too much, and you know already how you're going to use it. So read the label first. There's two main ways that we use insecticides to kill spotted lanternfly. There are contact sprays. And then the second group are the systemics, which get absorbed into the tree and make the whole tree toxic. The contact sprays, you have to get it on the bodies of the lanternflies. So you have to consider what kind of equipment you have. If this is your sprayer, you're probably not going to get up real high in the tree with this. And don't get up on a ladder. That's, you know, especially with liquid in a backpack sprayer, because it gets your center of gravity changed. And if you try to spray above your head, you're going to have drift coming back down on yourself, and you potentially could expose yourself to the pesticide. So if you want to try to spray big, tall trees, you're probably going to need to have some help to do that, unless for some reason you have equipment that is appropriate. And then in our Penn State information, under that management button, there's very specific information about what we know works. So in order for it to be something that Penn State will recommend, we need to have done a research experiment to prove that it is effective. Well, we know that some of the traditional insecticides like carbaryl and malathion definitely kill spotted lanternfly. We've tested a lot of the pyrethroids, and some of them have a long residual activity, which means they can keep killing the lanternfly for a couple weeks of time, which is a good thing if you're trying to clean up, you know, a living space from a nuisance. And we know pyrethrins will work. Now, pyrethrin is a natural extract of chrysanthemum flowers. And the pyrethrins are available at garden centers. They do not have long residual life. Pyrethroids are synthetically manufactured analogs of pyrethrins, and they add protectants to those formulations so they have this long residual life, doesn't break down in the sunlight, stuff like that. So, you know, I know this is a lot of chemistry here, but I think for homeowners, for people that are not licensed applicators, I think pyrethrins is probably as strong as I would go. And I have this list organized with the strongest, most toxic products at the top end. So some other things that can kill spotted lanternfly: neem oil, that's an extract of a tree. Spinosad, that's an extract of a soil microbe. And it is, you know, some of these pyrethrins, neem, spinosad, insecticidal soap, botanical oils, they're allowed if you're growing food for organic sale. So they're just the lower toxicity products, and I encourage you to try them first. So when you use these lower toxicity products, the lanternflies don't die immediately. You have to have a little patience, but, you know, treat them and then go away and come back 2 days later and see what it looks like then. You do need to get it on their body, so good coverage is important. And if you're spraying spotted lanternfly in your landscape with anything, they don't like to be sprayed. They'll jump off of whatever it is they're on, and they'll jump right back up on you. So whatever insecticide you're using, you know, wear long sleeves, wear a face mask. They will jump right back on you, so protect yourself. I have Bavaria bassiana on the list of contact sprays. You can buy that as a formulated product. We're not recommending it enthusiastically yet because we don't have data to back it up, but it is labeled and it is available. And if you want to try it, you can try it. So if anybody has great success with Bavaria bassiana in your home landscape, let me know. Give me a call. All right, and then those are the contact sprays. The other category are the systemics. And we know there are two insecticides that you can apply to trees, and you got to, you know, follow the directions, but you can get them into the entire tree, systemically into the entire tree, and protect that tree from spotted lanternfly. The active ingredients that we know work the best are dinotefuran and imidacloprid. So these are all available. These are both available on to people that you don't have to have a license to buy them, but you have to make sure you're doing the application right in order to get it to work. They tend to be a little more expensive than some of the contact sprays, so you don't want to waste the money by not applying it properly and having it work. So we are using the Tree of Heaven and how much that it you know, lanternfly loves Tree of Heaven, and we're using them as a trap tree to kill spotted lanternfly, but you can use really any tree as a trap tree. So for Tree of Heaven, the majority of the trees, if you have a stand of Tree of Heaven, the majority of the trees are killed. And then you treat the remaining trees with a systemic insecticide. And the agencies are doing this. They're using dinotefuran products. Then the lanternflies, this is the time of year where they're flocking to the Tree of Heaven, and they will feed and die. So this is a picture of a Tree of Heaven trap tree, and the lanternflies will just keep piling up underneath this tree. You can use these systemic insecticides on other trees and use those trees as trap trees as well. So this is a really important point, though. If you're doing insecticide treatment on your property, you need to remember you can't stop more spotted lanternfly from moving onto the property. So these are pictures from my coworker, Brian Walsh. We're looking at the root flare, the base of the trunk of a silver maple that he treated with dinotefuran, one of the systemic insecticides. He treated it on August 5th of 2017. By the 13th, the lanternflies, you know, they're coming to this tree, they're feeding, they're dying, they're dropping to the ground. By October 6th, this was inches deep. And you're killing lanternflies. They're not drawing lots of sap out of this tree in your yard, but then you have dead piles of insects around, and they do start to stink after a while. So, you know, it gets rid of some of the nuisance, but then it creates another sort of nuisance. So just be aware of that. If you're treating your trees, you can't stop more from coming. They're going to keep coming. I wanted to just mention that, you know, people often ask me, what is my risk to using insecticides? And they're very interested in how toxic the products are. But the other important part of the equation is the exposure. So how much were you exposed to? What is the length of time you are exposed? How often do you use it? How are you exposed? Don't forget, you can use a very toxic insecticide, and if you protect yourself, your risk from that pesticide is less than if you use something that's medium in toxicity and you wind up, you know, somehow exposing yourself with drift or you know, taking a bath in it. So exposure is really important. We're also reminding everybody to protect our pollinators. So some of these, especially the systemics, if that gets into the tree and gets into the pollen and the nectar of flowering trees, I'm showing a red maple in flower. And, you know, we're a little concerned if people treat red maples with systemic insecticides late in the season, could it carry over in that tree and be present in harmful levels for the when the flowers bloom in the spring and the pollinators are all going to the flowers? So read the labels of the products. Never spray insecticides on a tree that is in flower or is about to flower. And read the labels. Every label has specific information about how to protect our important pollinators. All right, and I'm going to kind of try to wrap it all together now. We have a fact sheet on our website that we have tried to draw out how to make these decisions. Everybody's situation is different. So the first thing is to assess your risk. Consider what is your spotted lanternfly population size and how vulnerable are your plants. So on this chart, we're saying, you know, think about the severity of the infestation. Is it acceptable, tolerable, undesirable, or intolerable? And then think about how likely the spotted lanternfly is to have an impact. Do you have plants that are, maybe you only have plants that the lanternfly doesn't really like pine, spruce, arborvitae. Maybe your plants in your landscape, you know, they really do kind of like them. So you have maples, birch, ailanthus, willow. Maybe the plants you have in your landscape have additional stress going on. So that makes them more vulnerable to, you know, the additional stress of spotted lanternfly. And then proximity to vulnerable plants. Are you next to a vineyard? Do you have a lot of, other kind of plant production around that you're trying to protect? So all of these things figure into your risk assessment, which goes from low, medium, high to extreme. And there's a lot of personal preference in here as well and kind of personal comfort level. So you kind of figure out where you are in the risk category and the risk spectrum. And then the next thing is to consider your range of options. Now, I mentioned integrated pest management. This is a philosophy where you choose the least toxic actions first. And we usually talk about integrated pest management using a triangle diagram. So the first things to try are cultural practices. Promote the health of the plant, eliminate undesirable host plants preferred by spotted lanternfly. Don't assume that every plant problem is caused by spotted lanternfly. Get an expert diagnosis. And our county extension office can help you with that. The Bucks County Extension Office can help you. The Philadelphia County Office. We offer diagnosis services if you call your county. Physical and mechanical methods would be scraping eggs into alcohol or hand sanitizer, which has alcohol in them, or smash the eggs. You can use sticky bands, but use wildlife guards to capture nymphs or adults. Swat, smash, or stomp or vacuum nymphs and adults. So any mechanical method, that's a great thing to try. Then there's this biological control category. We want to conserve natural enemies like spiders, praying mantids, and assassin bugs, the wheel bug that I showed you, by reducing broad-spectrum insecticide use. So make your landscape friendly to those creatures. Naturally occurring fungi that kills spotted lanternfly may help, especially in wet seasons. But at this point, we're not recommending buying biological products and saying that we think it will work. So I've had a lot of people ask about buying praying mantids, and you can buy them, but we don't think that it's really going to help the spotted lanternfly population that much, help reduce the spotted lanternfly population that much. And then the last part of the integrated pest management triangle is the chemical piece. And within the chemical, and these are the insecticides, there are softer things like insecticidal soap, horticultural spray oil, botanical oils, neems, pyrethrins, and these have short or no residual activity. So maybe that's, you know, maybe you get that far in your management option decision process. And then there are EPA registered insecticides that can be used as contact or systemics that are stronger. So the pyrethroids, carbaryl, malathion, dinotefuran, imidacloprid, some have longer residual activity. And you really have to learn and read the label so you know how to use those products properly to get them to work and to be as safe as you can be for you. So as you're working your way up this triangle, the environmental impact and the cost may increase. So that's a lot of information in two charts, but that's how we try to help people think about the spotted lanternfly situation that they're facing and to give them tools to help them pick out what might work for them. So just a reminder, the spotted lanternfly Penn State website, it's easy to find. A lot of great information there. There's recorded videos of varying lengths and levels of detail. Lots of stuff there. And we know we have a really long road ahead of us with this. So the bottom line is spot it, make sure you know how to identify it, destroy it, but use recommended practices. Report it. It is important to report it. Researchers are using that information. The governmental agencies are using that information. So we're asking everybody to report at least once a season to either 1-888-4-BAD-FLY, you can call it in, or you can go to the Penn State Spotted Lanternfly website and one of the buttons says report. You can report right online there. And don't move them around. So that really is the bottom line. I want to thank a lot of people for slides and images and thoughts and ideas. And I am going to try to help answer your questions now.
Emily, thank you so much again for this wonderful presentation. Every single time that, Sue, I've seen this a couple times now, you learn more each and every time. And I wanted to just thank you for your explanation and some of the new information that you put in there. So I really do appreciate it. And I think This is fantastic information, and it's important that, you know, we understand what it is that we can actually do to help stop this spread, mitigate the spread, and also what are some of the things that we can utilize, either from natural remedies to what's commercially made. So I don't want to take any more time. I want to actually jump into these questions. Before that, I wanted to make sure that everybody knew that if you do have questions that you still want to ask, you can call in to our phone number and you can email that too. So I wanted to go through the phone number is 267-768-3671. Leave a message and we will actually put that into our chat to ask the question. In addition to that, you can email us at repmalagari@pahouse.net. I'll say that again. It's repmalagari@pahouse.net. So without further ado, let's move forward with some questions from some of our audience members. And the first question that I wanted to ask, so a constituent has a balcony that has a grapevine that is covered in spotted lanternflies. And this individual has not been able to find an effective bug killer that won't kill the grapevine. So what steps can be taken to fix this so this individual can use their balcony again?
Yeah, so use a registered insecticide. I imagine this time of year there's adult lanternflies on this grapevine, and even a product like insecticidal soap, according to the label, won't hurt the grapevine. Now, if you, you know, go, if you go to the kitchen and you get the dish liquid, you could burn the leaves of the grape and cause more damage than the lanternflies are causing. So use a registered insecticide, go to a garden center. For a grapevine, you're probably not going to have very much luck with the little pre-made bottles that, you know, you get a hand cramp trying to use them, and you're going to need something that's bigger. So you can buy insecticidal soap, neem oil, even pyrethrins as a concentrate. And then if you get a little sprayer, they're usually a white plastic sprayer that you pump up. You can usually get a sprayer for, I don't know, under $20, sometimes closer to $10. And read the label, measure the amount, put it in the sprayer. And then, you know, I would still wear long sleeves and, you know, they're going to jump around. So protect yourself, and you can go and spray that grapevine. And those products that I mentioned would work very well against that. There's also the other option of hiring a professional to come in and do that application. And in a lot of cases, that's a good value because these are people that have the equipment, the training, and, you know, you don't have to get involved with the insecticides.
Emily, as a follow-up to that, is there a place that constituents can go to, homeowners can go to find a professional? Is there a listing anywhere that they can look at, or are we looking at a Google search or something like that?
Yeah, it's a great question. On our Penn State Spotted Lanternfly website under Manage, there is a fact sheet on how to choose a good professional. So things to look for. You want to ask if they have a commercial pesticide license from the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture. In order for them to treat legally on your property, they need to have that. You can ask them if they have liability insurance. And again, to legally apply that pesticide, they need to have that. And they should happily provide you with a copy of that certificate. You can ask them for recommendations or references. So you can call somebody that they worked with before and, you know, find out how well they liked that company. There are a lot of companies out there right now that are selling spotted lanternfly services. Everybody should know that you have the option. You are in the driver's seat. So if you want them to come in and treat your one plant, you don't have to buy the whole program. But if you want to buy the whole program, they certainly offer that.
That's good information to know, and thank you for that. The next question is from Michelle. I wanted to read this off. So I'm seeing spotted lanternfly on my house and on my windows. I've seen two or three in my house that were dead. As much as I don't want them to destroy my trees, I really don't want them in my home. I've sprayed insecticide on the inside of my windows in my home, but can't get to the second floor on the outside of my home. What would you recommend, and why are they on buildings and homes?
Yeah, that's a great question. This is the time of year when they start, the adults start to fly around a lot. And they are attracted to vertical objects like homes. They especially like the sunny, warmer sides of the buildings for some reason. What you need to know, first of all, is that it won't last forever. They're going to go through this flight pattern for a couple weeks, and then it's really going to subside, and they'll be back onto the trees. They're not going to hurt your house. They can't feed on the wood or the structure of the house, and they're really not going to hurt it. When they're on the side of the house, they try to go up, and they go to the highest point, and then they fly away from the house. They're trying to go find another tree to feed on. So if you do nothing to your house, some of them won't get that far. They can't feed on anything in the house, so some will die and they'll fall to the ground. You can just blow them away with a leaf blower or a broom. And you don't need to treat homes with toxic insecticides. Every now and then, if you have some way for them to get into a window or around a window, one or two can find their way into the house. They're going to die in there. And they don't hurt people and don't bite. So, you know, as much as it's not fun to have an insect in your house, it's better to just use a piece of paper and a little brush and sweep them up and throw them out when that happens, rather than putting pesticides into your living space. So we're not recommending that people treat the insides of homes at all. And if you have, only in special, very unusual circumstances have we said treat the outside of a residence. That exception, the only time I ever said to do that was a nursing home where they wanted to have their residents in wheelchairs out on a balcony, and there were just lanternflies everywhere. So they had a commercial pest control company come in and use an insecticide that was labeled for use that way. It worked to kill the lanternflies. The people could be out on the deck again, but more kept coming. You can't stop them from coming. So, you know, at some point you have to kind of adjust your expectations because the lanternfly is going to keep coming.
Well, thank you for that. And thank you for the disclaimer as to not spray insecticide in somebody's home. I think that's an important takeaway from that. I did have a follow-up question from the same individual. So Michelle said her friends and family are doing everything they can, their due diligence in killing them. She doesn't think that they're able to control this infestation with just us and members of the public killing them and hoping that we spot an egg nest in the spring and get rid of those. So what's the state doing, and are they doing anything as far as trying to control these besides us killing them? And I actually have that answer here, and I was going to read it off. So Penn State University Extension and also the United States Department of Agriculture, the USDA, and the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture, PDA, as they refer to, have joined forces to control and contain the spread of spotted lanternfly. Penn State University is actually leading the research efforts currently underway to answer many questions that we have about the insect's biology, the pesticide studies, and the ability of the insect to adopt the environment in Pennsylvania. And the USDA and the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture are actively treating locations where spotted lanternfly has been reported. And the USDA is actually treating on the outer edges where the populations are small and will begin to move inward towards the center of the quarantine. And then the Department of Agriculture is treating areas where the population numbers are much higher and is targeting very high-risk pathways, which may contribute to moving the insect to other locations. So as funding is available, both the USDA and the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture will continue to work on properties for treatment. And the Department of Agriculture from Pennsylvania is also surveying all counties in the state outside the quarantine, looking for spotted lanternfly as well. Is there anything you'd like to add to that, Emily?
No, I think you said it very well. In our area, we have so many lanternflies. The U.S. Department of Ag and the Pennsylvania Department of Ag are protecting high-risk corridors, so transportation, you know, venues, you know, places that ship a lot of products out. But they're using the resources they have as best they can, and we need everybody's help to suppress the population and be very careful that just the general public doesn't move the lanternfly to other areas. And we're hoping that the research catches up and starts to give us more tools that we can use on, you know, on bigger scale areas. So that's what we've been trying to do with the Bavaria Bassiana trials. And, you know, we just need more time. So we need everybody to keep killing them. Every lanternfly that you kill has a 50% chance of being a female. And if it's a female, she has the potential to generate another 100 or more lanternflies for next year. So keep stomping them. Oh, you're muted. You need to unmute.
My apologies, Emily. What I was saying was if you want to keep your presentation up on the screen, you're more than welcome to. If you wanted to close that out, we can just talk back and forth. We can do that too. But I'll let you decide on how you want to do it. I think everyone did have a good opportunity to collect all of your contact information, and thank you for that. And we'll have another
sure.
opportunity, I think, toward the end if you want, in order to do that as well. So I have a third question. So just like Japanese beetles, when you buy the bag to catch them, it draws more to your property. And they say not to really use those bags. So are the insecticides attracting the spotted lanternflies?
Not that we know of. We think more so the trees and plant material that you have is attracting the lanternfly.
That's comforting to know.
Yeah, especially if you have Tree of Heaven, and if you do and you can get rid of it, you know, get rid of it.
Okay. I wanted just to remind everybody, if you do have questions, email them through to repmaligari@pahouse.net. And also you can call them in to 267-768-3671. We'll be here for a couple more moments to try and get some more questions if they've come through. And I wanted to make sure that everybody had a chance to ask some questions. So again, repmaligari@pahouse.net. for your email of your question, and also you can call it in at 267-768-3671. So, Emily, are there any parting words that you wanted to talk about?
Well, that last question prompts me to tell you that there are researchers that are looking for attractants for a lanternfly. So if we could find something that attracted them, we could come up with like Japanese beetle bags for lanternflies and put those attractants in the traps. So there's been a group out of the U.S. Department of Agriculture in Massachusetts that has been working very hard on trying to develop these attractants. And they haven't found anything that's like successful enough to make it commercial yet. But they're doing their work in Pennsylvania. So, you know, we have a lot of landowners that are cooperating with these researchers, and researchers coming from, you know, far and wide to try to find better answers. But boy, if we could find a real attractant for lanternfly, that would be another great tool to have.
Has the research shown anything that shows that the Tree of Heaven has a certain chemical compound that the lanternfly is attracted to? And is it possible to replicate that as an attractant?
Yeah, that's exactly what this group is trying to do. They have a device called a Y-tube, and it's a glass tube that has, you know, one stem and then two branches. And they put a lanternfly in the stem, and they put two different kinds of plants in the branches, and then they see which direction the lanternfly goes to. So we know the Tree of Heaven, when it's healthy and vigorous, has a real attractant to them. But the group hasn't been able to identify one particular chemical that can be manufactured in a scale that would be useful yet. But they're working on it, and you know, wouldn't that be great? And I'm really rooting for them.
Yeah, that would be wonderful. And I know that we've all seen the spotted lanternfly climbing up the big buildings, and you know, hopping onto our cars and hopping onto our own selves, actually. Mm-hmm. And it while definitely an annoyance, it's more important that we understand that we do have to do our best to try and eradicate as best as possible, as it is invasive and can cause a lot of harm to our economy and also to our fruit plants and grapevines, as we've learned, and maple. And there's so much damage that can happen and is currently happening, you know, from them.
Yeah.
Killing some trees that we do have. This would be a really great opportunity, I think, for us to attract and catch and really just get rid of them as best as possible and really prevent further spread. Because as we learned, you know, 60 eggs at a time, or roughly about 60 eggs in one laying, that's an amazing amount of replication in one life cycle for an insect to do.
They're really just an unusual insect in so many ways that makes them really a formidable foe. So their ability to replicate to high numbers, you know, their ability to feed on so many different kinds of plants, the way they move around so much, it makes them a real challenge.
Yeah, and I know that as one of the things I'll ask for everyone on that's listening in, just be persistent. Be persistent about, you know, when you see them out as you're going about your day in your yard or in your neighborhood or even running an errand right now. If you see one in the parking lot, try and stomp it. Make sure that we do the best we can. I want to ask you, what's your best method? What's your weapon of choice, if you will, when it comes down to killing a spotted lanternfly?
Yeah, well, I protected several of our trees this year using the homemade circle traps. So if you're handy about things like that, like I said, you can buy them from one commercial company, and you can use them year after year. I killed thousands and thousands of nymphs with circle traps this year, and I didn't hurt other wildlife. So I think for me, I like the circle traps because once you get them on the trees, you don't really have to do much. I check them every other day or so, and I did change the bags twice. But, you know, that fits into my lifestyle, and I know I'm protecting the tree because I see the bags filling up. I have protected some of my landscape plants where I had high populations, and it was right where my picnic table is, by using insecticidal soap. I bought the concentrated product at the garden center. I have one of those little sprayers and just sprayed what I could reach. And I did that. I had to do it twice, but after that, I could use the picnic table again. So, you know, so I will resort to sprays, but I don't have equipment to, you know, do big applications. I think if I had a landscape where I had trees that were really favorite trees and it had masses of spotted lanternflies on it last year, it's very likely they'll come back to that tree again this year. I think if I had that situation, I would consider using the systemic insecticides. So I would probably consider having a professional do it, but you can do it yourself. You just need to make sure you do it right. You don't want to underdose the trees because then it won't work. You don't want to overdose the trees because you're wasting your money. But I would consider doing that. You're really using a very small amount of insecticide in a very targeted way. So I think I would choose that method, you know, for my personal preferences over maybe the big sprays, you know, that are contact sprays. But everybody's situation is different.
Well, I appreciate that. And I wanted to thank you for your time. I really do appreciate it. And thank you for all the information. And I know that this will be this particular video will be available for members of the public to see and go back to and reference.
I appreciate that. It's been a very big help
to a lot of constituents. We've gotten a lot of thank yous with regard to this. And I want to thank you again for all of your time spending with us this evening. And I wanted to just thank everybody again for being on, spending time with us. And thanks again to my staff for helping to run this and administer this forum and this town hall about the spotted lanternfly. And I'll leave you with the last word, Emily, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of the evening as well.
Thank you. Well, thank you for the opportunity. It's great to have the chance to get the word out to people in, you know, such an area with so many lanternflies. And please share the information with your friends and neighbors. A lot of the content of what I talked about tonight is on the Spotted Lanternfly website, so check it out. And if you have individual questions, probably the best place to go is to call 1-888-4-BAD-FLY. And that's our Penn State hotline. We have a bank of people that are managing, you know, the calls that come in there, and they'll work with you individually and answer people's questions about their unique situations.
So let me ask that again. That's 1-888-4.
The number
and then
4.
BADFLY, and however that spells out on the,
that's right.
on the phone.
Yes, understood. That's exactly it.
We could probably get that up onto our website as well, just
oh,
to make sure
awesome.
That everybody has that information. So again, that's 1-888-4-BAD-FLY to ask any questions as well. Emily, thank you so much. I really do appreciate it. And thank you to Penn State Extension, a wonderful organization, and continue with the good work and the good research on the spotted lanternfly. Hopefully we'll have that attractant isolated so we can really make it in commercial scale, so we can actually start to really mitigate these invasive insects and try and get ahead of this and make sure that we don't see much more spread across our country too. So this has been a fantastic evening. Thank you again, and have a wonderful evening.
Okay, thank you. Good night.
Have a good night. These invasive insects and try and get ahead of this and make sure that we don't see much more spread across our country too. So this has been a fantastic evening. Thank you again, and have a wonderful evening.
Okay, thank you. Good night.
Have a good night. These invasive insects and try and get ahead of this and make sure that we don't see much more.